We do not study nature because it is useful. We study because we delight in it. And we delight in it because it is beautiful. If nature were not beautiful, it would not be worth knowing. And if nature were not worth knowing, life would not be worth living. A bright, propitious morning to one and all. Reverend Director Sir, Worthy Registrar Sir, Distinguished Chief Guest Professor T.V. Ramakrishnan, esteemed faculty members, and all the curious souls who have joined us virtually, I, Sarabjot, on the behalf of Department of Physics at NITJ, extend a sincere welcome to the 5-day online short-term course titled Current Trends in Condensed Matter Physics 2020. Ever wondered why a ceramic mug is good for handling hot liquids and would break if I dropped it? Why a stainless steel fork does not attract a paperclip right now, but would if held up to a big honking magnet? Why diamonds are so flawless? Believe me, condensed matter physics is the sole key. There is not an iota of doubt that CMP is one of the most versatile subfields of study in physics. It is simultaneously useful and fundamental, simultaneously mundane and fantastical, simultaneously large and small, with some of the most mind-boggling but cool phenomena. Almost every aspect of our daily life benefits from research in CMP. For instance, composite materials are used in jet turbines. Superconducting magnets are used in MRI tomography for medical diagnostics. Various solid-state sensors and detectors for space exploration and homeland security. And lasers for entertainment, broadband communication, and whatnot. These, in turn, have led to the spectacular growth of modern computer and telecommunication industries, and consequently, to the information revolution. CMP is the hinge upon which all technological applications rely. Liquid crystals, modern plastics, and composite materials. Discovery of Bose-Einstein condensate, and the latest being graphene as a new superconductor, are all nothing but the stunning gifts of CMP. This ESTC is carefully designed to highlight the latest developments with firm understanding of the basics in the field. I now invite the extremely dedicated coordinator of the course, Dr. Vinod Ishokan, Assistant Professor, Department of Physics, to welcome the participants and shed light on the details of the course. Sir, please.
Thank you, Sarabjot. A very warm welcome to one and all present in the inaugural ceremony of 5 days online short-term course on current trends in condensed matter physics. Greeting to all the dignitary presents. It's a pleasure to be here today with the Honorable Chief Guest of the event, Professor T.V. Ramakrishnan, Padam Shri Fellow of Royal Society, DST Year of Science Chair Professor, Department of Atomic Energy, Homi Bhabha Professor, Distinguished Associate, Industrial Science, Bangalore. Professor Lalit Kumar Avasthi, Director, NIT Jalandhar. Professor Ken Pathak, former Vice Chancellor, Punjab University. Dr. S.K. Sinha, Dean RNC. Dr. S.K. Mishra, Registrar, NIT Jalandhar. Dr. Harleen Dhaiya, Head of Physics Department, faculty member of the Department of Physics, and various other department faculty member who are joining us through Google Meet. And my dear online participant, on behalf of Department of Physics, a very warm, wholehearted welcome to this online short-term course on current trends in condensed matter physics. This STC will be run from 25th September to 29th September 2020. This is being organized to give a detailed introduction to the research area of current interest in the field of theoretical condensed matter physics. Among the various topics of current interest, the course will focus on themes related to quantum liquids, fermions, and bosons, electronic structure and strongly correlated system, electron correlation effects in low dimension. The response of this STC is overwhelming. We have got a participation of 763 participants registered for this course. Some will be joining us through Google Meet, and other will be catching us live through YouTube streaming. So I take pride in welcoming Professor T.V. Ramakrishnan, the chief guest and resource person for this e-program. So your presence here is truly momentous for us and very encouraging, not only for participants, but also for the faculty of Department of Physics at NIT Jalandhar. Thank you for willingly accepting our invitation for being here with us today, sir. In a short while, now the participant will have privilege in listening to his expert talk. Thanks to Professor Lalit Kumar Awasthi, Director at NIT Jalandhar, for inspiring us for organizing the most exciting, informative, stimulating and memorable events from time to time. I'm feeling proud to share that under his visionary and dynamic leadership, NIT Jalandhar has reached at 52 NIRF ranking and has been placed in the band of 11 to 25 ranked by AICT-MHRD for utter ranking of Institute on Innovation and Achievement 2020. I'm also glad to inform you all that under this pandemic situation, NIT Jalandhar family worked diligently for development of knowledge through online courses, visual conference, R&D activities. During this pandemic, 4 patent and 1 technology transfer has been made with respect to COVID-19, and total of 11 patent and 3 technology transfers have been done during the last 3 months. We are very fortunate to have great mentor like you, sir. Thank you for your support, and your support has been commendable, and thank you for being with us always and today for the inaugural ceremony. Thank you one and all, and I look forward to a very fruitful session that follows. And now I invite Dr. Harleen Dhaiya, Head of Physics Department, to say a few words. Thank you.
So thank you, Vinod. Good morning, everyone. So I'm very pleased to be here today to extend to you all a very hearty and warm welcome on behalf of the Department of Physics for this ESTC, Current Trends in Condensed Matter Physics. So I consider it a very special honor to welcome Professor Lalit Kumar Awasthi, Director, NITJ, as our inspiring mentor. We will always be indebted to you, sir, for taking our institute amongst the highly ranked institutions. And this has further led to optimism and self-confidence that next year we are going to do even better. So your far-sighted vision and support has persuaded the faculty to think big and out of the box. We have in him a very strong leader who is leading this institution dynamically. We were discussing it yesterday only that the best thing about our director is that he's always there to hear us, and he's supporting the faculty despite having charge of 2 institutions. On Monday, he was connected with us while traveling in his car, and this shows his dedication and sincerity to his work. We have to learn a lot from you, sir, and have to go a long way. We would like to extend a special welcome to our guest of honor, Padam Shri Professor T.V. Ramakrishnan, who would be speaking shortly. He is well known among all physicists and is a source of motivation for many researchers. I am so thankful to you for accepting our invitation and agreeing to deliver a talk. I am sure the young researchers will gain a lot. I also feel very happy and privileged to welcome Professor K.N. Pathak. He has been my teacher and still is. Whenever we meet, there is still something to learn from him. He has been the most humble, learned, and helpful teacher I have ever met. So I also feel very happy to see so many colleagues and students. We are without a doubt specially grateful to you to join us here today. So thank you all and wish you all the best, Dr. Vinod and Dr. Shishram. Hope you have a successful course. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am, for leading our way. Many thanks to you, Dr. Vinod Ashokan and Dr. Shishram Ribari, sir, for successfully planning this knowledge platform. CMP is intellectually stimulating due to the continuing discoveries of many new phenomena and development of new concepts to understand them. As a result, over the past 50 years, 27 Nobel Prizes in Physics were awarded to CMP and related areas. The graph is forever on rise. With due respect, I now invite our respected director, sir, Dr. L.K. Awasthi, to welcome our honorable guest and share his inspirational message with us. Sir, please.
Good morning and greetings from NIT Jalandhar. Hi, on my personal behalf and on behalf of NIT Jalandhar, welcome Professor T.B. Ramakrishnan ji, who is a distinguished professor and par excellence, and he has been awarded with so many awards, Santi Swarup Bhatnagar Award for Physical Sciences, Padam Shri, and so on and so forth. So we are privileged to have you as chief guest for this inaugural function. I again welcome Professor K.N. Pathak ji, who has been kind enough to be here on this inaugural function, and the head of department, Dr. Harleen Dahiya, the coordinator, Ashok Vinod Ashokan, and then Dr. Shishram, and all the participants. It's my pleasure to be here on inaugural function of this short-term course. I'll take a couple of minutes in introducing the institute. This institute came as Regional Engineering College Jalandhar in 1987, and with a humble beginning of 100 students. Later on, the institute progressed gradually. We were deemed university in 2002 and NIT. And then later on, this institute was rechristened as Institute of National Importance in 2007 by Act of Parliament. And ever since its beginning, the institute has seen continuous progress with M.Tech and PhD program starting in 2006. The institute now offers 11 undergraduate programs in various areas of engineering. We have 16 M.Tech program, MSc program in physics, chemistry, mathematics, and we have MBA program. Roughly every year, institute takes around 125 research scholars. And as has been told by Dr. Ashokan, the institute is on a path of continuous progress. All credits to the faculty, students, and staff of the institute. We have recently, in around 7 months, the institute faculty and students have published more than 450 publications, which is a record. During pandemic time, the four technologies has been transferred to the industry, and we have declared this as year of innovation and patenting. The another good thing is that during pandemic, the faculty of the institute, they're coming together for such short-term courses, and we have organized more than 30 short-term courses for the benefit of faculty and students all, throughout our own country as well as abroad. This topic has been chosen very aptly, that condensed matter physics. And we know that in almost every aspect of our daily life, we benefit from research in this area. And with the galaxy of people coming from IIT, TIFR, and ICER, IIT Mandi, I think that it is going to be great learning experience for all the participants, and hope that during this pandemic time, they can make best of their time. Also, I hope that everyone connected is safe and comes out of this, the humanity as a whole comes out of this pandemic at an early date. Thank you. Jai Hind, Jai Bharat.
Thank you, sir, for your blessings and for your kind words and gracious presence. I now request Dr. Ashokan to kindly introduce our chief guest, Professor TBR, and invite him for his expert talk and sharing us his pearls of wisdom.
Thank you, sir. Jyot. It's my pleasure to welcome Professor T.B. Ramakrishnan, or TBR, as he is called in a true South Indian traditional way of initializing people. He is one of the eminent condensed matter physicists today in India, whose reputation precedes his work. He has made a crucial contribution to our understanding of condensed matter physics. His pioneering work started two major areas of activity, the liquid solid transition, as well as related phenomena in dense classical system and onset of electron localization in disordered system. He has also made many significant contribution to their growth in a third area, namely mixed valence in a rare earth metal. His work on the inverse orbital degeneracy expansion has had a major effect in the field. He is currently a distinguished associate at the Center for Condensed Matter Theory, Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore, India. And he is a DE Homi Bhabha Professor at BHU, Varanasi, and DST Year of Science Chair Professor. He has completed his BSc with honors in physics and mathematics and MSc in physics from BHU in 1959 and 1961, respectively, and PhD in physics from Columbia University, New York, USA. His professional career is over the globe. He worked as an assistant research physicist at University of California, San Diego, Professor IIT Kanpur, visiting fellow, visiting professor, Princeton University, USA, and consultant at AT&T Bell Laboratory, USA, Rothschild, visiting professor, Isaac Newton Institute for Mathematical Science, Cambridge University, visiting fellow, Trinity College, visiting professor, Cambridge University, UK. With 129 research publications, a dozen of review articles, 4 books, and 11 journal articles in his academic crown. He has been associated with innumerable national and international institutes of repute. He is a fellow of Indian Academy of Science, Bangalore, Indian National Science Academy, American Physical Society, Third World Academy of Sciences, National Academy of Sciences, Royal Society, Fellow of Royal Society, London, Institute of Physics, Honorary Fellow, TFR Bombay, Foreign Associate, Academia des Sciences, Paris, France, Honorary Associate, IACS, Kolkata. He has served a member of various scientific councils like ICTP, Italy, Science and Engineering Research Council, DST India, Indian National Science Academy, Center for Liquid Crystal Research, Bangalore, IUSC, ICER Pune, IIT Delhi, Science Advisory Council to Prime Minister from 2005 to 2014. And the list is endless. Equally long is his list of distinctions and award. Higgins Fellow, President Fellow, Columbia University, Swanti Swarup Bhatnagar Award for Physical Science, CSIR India, and 1982, Simi Raman Centenary Medal, Indian Science Congress, and Padam Shri, President of India in 2001. Meghna Saha Medal, Asiatic Society Kolkata, Distinguished Material Scientist of the Year, Material Research Society of India, and latest being the G.N. Ramchandran Award in Physics in 2016. So without much delay, I invite Professor Ramakrishnan to bless us with his pearl of wisdom as the first talk of this ESTC. Sir, please. It's a matter of great privilege for all of us to have such a decorated scientist among with us today. Sir, please.
Yeah, I'm trying to do that. To resume my presentation. Okay. Resume presenting. Fine. Nothing seems to be happening. Are you able to see my screen or no? See my talk? No.
No, sir.
No. No. Okay. I don't know what to do, but let me see. You are presenting. Okay, I did that. Yeah, I'm sorry I'm causing trouble to everyone, but I'm doing what I was told to do, but it's not working. Let us see.
Maybe you can stop presenting and then present again. So I think that
will Yeah, you have to first, you have to first stop presenting and then try again.
And then present again, yeah, present now then.
Okay. I'm doing that.
Present now?
Yeah, I'm presenting now. but I'm not seeing anything.
A window present. A window. You can see a window.
Yeah.
Present now. A window. Yeah.
It says something shared. Okay.
Yes.
Is anything coming? No. Okay. Sorry, I am presenting my screen.
Yeah, now it's okay.
Yeah, it's coming, sir.
Something is coming, but I am not seeing what is coming.
So you just open your PowerPoint presentation. Yes, that's fine. That's fine, sir.
Good.
That's fine. Now it's okay.
See me, you can see the top.
Yes.
You hear me, that is fine. All right. But firstly, I want to thank Professor Ashokan, and I want to thank all of you for enabling me to participate in this great enterprise. You see, it is it's something very great because condensed matter physics is a very strange beast. It is one of the that part of physics which at the same time very interesting from the point of view of ideas and principles and methods and so on, and also is very useful for society. In that sense, it is actually very close to the fundamentals of modern science. You see, when modern science started, there was a lot of dispute on what it should be, and it was Francis Bacon who argued that it should have both direct observation and relevance to society as its foci, and that is what condensed matter physics is becoming. In that part of physics, I have been interested in something called strong electronic correlations, namely actually metals with strong electronic correlations. And in this talk, I'll try to talk about this field, summarize our working picture of metals, mention some properties of strongly correlated strongly electron correlated metals, some theoretical attempts at making sense of their properties, and mention two characteristic applications. These applications are just beginning, and so it's actually a wide open field in that sense. In order to sort of give some realistic picture of the hopes which people have about this field, I have shown here in this slide a very sort of expansive, colorful diagram of possible relevance of this field. You see, it starts with what is called quantum materials. And you notice that strong correlation, which is the theme of my talk, feeds into quantum materials, which feeds into Mottronics, superconductivity, quantum computing, topological electronics, magnetoelectronics, and so on. And then on the right, you see how quantum materials are connected to electricity, magnetism, heat, mechanics, and light, and this connection is two-way, and well, I mean, this is a sort of hopeful compilation of various mantras associated with this area of enterprise. I think it just sort of makes us happy that we are in a large world in which subject of strong correlations plays an important role. To begin with, what I will say, I will start with what our mental map is of metals. I mean, we all know metals. I mean, like copper is a metal, iron is a steel is a metal, and so on and so forth. Now, in our mind, the map of a metal is like this, that, well, a metal consists of a collection of more or less independent electrons which are moving around over large distances in this piece of which is generally a solid. like in copper wire, there are a lot of electrons which are moving from end to end when you apply a voltage to this piece of wire. Now, the idea that it consists of a collection of a large number of independent electrons is actually due to Drude, who said in 1900, just about 3 years after electrons were discovered, that the electrons in metals form a classical ideal gas. Now, this is a very far-fetched, proposition or hypothesis, because firstly, the density of electrons, let us say in copper, is more than 1,000 times larger than the density of molecules in gaseous air. I mean, like you look at air, you know, which consists of nitrogen and oxygen, and you say, well, it's more or less an ideal gas. You say the same thing of electrons in metals, but the density of electrons in metals is more than 1,000 times larger. So it's still not exactly clear why this is so, but it works. Sometime later, not much later, about a quarter of a century later, there was a major correction to this idea. The major correction was that, well, it is still an ideal gas, but you think of it as a quantum ideal gas. Sorry, there was somebody calling and I have to switch him off. So this correction is due to Pauli in 1926 and Sommerfeld in 1927. They proposed that you can think of electrons in metals as forming a quantum ideal gas. Now this is, it's a concession to reality. And it is a concession which says that, look, it's a quantum gas, and though it's an ideal gas, and since it is a quantum gas, there is a characteristic temperature, which I have shown here. This number, you see, I don't know why I'm not able to get this cursor here, but it is a number which depends on the density of electrons in that system, and it is much larger than typical temperatures. I mean, this characteristic temperature is about 10,000 degrees or 20,000 degrees in most metals, and it is much higher than typical temperatures, room temperature, which is maybe 100 degrees above, 300 degrees above absolute zero, or even temperature in the sun, which are at the surface of the sun, maybe 6,000 degrees above absolute zero. So this was the idea, and this actually works. Then in the almost 100 years since then, we are getting more and more real. For example, just about 5 years after this was proposed by Sommerfeld and Pauli, it was realized that, well, you should not think of it as an ideal quantum, free quantum gas. The collection of any particles moving in a potential, which is due to the ions. The ions form a periodic lattice in a perfect crystal. So you think of the electrons as moving in this perfectly periodic lattice. I mean, it's an idealization, like most idealizations in physics, and it actually works. This gave rise in the hands of Wilson, 1931, to the energy band theory of solids. And he was the first person who said that we can classify metal is full or not full completely. Then later, a sophisticated description of electrons in solids was developed by Landau. He said that, well, you cannot think of them as free particles, but as quasi particles, which are nearly free. This is, as I keep saying, this simple picture works very well for many. In spite of all these interactions, you can qualitatively describe them as a collection of well-defined independent quasi-particles, and the entire effect of interaction can be fully incorporated by renormalizations. You describe it with a collection of independent quasi-particles with electron mass, with their mass m star. Now, this is reminiscent of what is done in quantum electrodynamics, where you say that there's an observed mass, there's an observed magnetic moment, etc., etc., and these are somehow dependent on the bare values. Now, in the 1980s, a fact was noticed, and this was the fact that a particular oxide called nickel oxide, which ought to be a metal according to the energy band theory of solids, is actually a good insulator. Now, this is a very disturbing fact because it is qualitative. You see, something ought to have been a metal according to the only available of solid, but it's an insulator. Now, in order to understand this, in 1999, Mott did an interesting thought experiment. He said, look, consider a collection of hydrogen atoms. Suppose these hydrogen atoms are somehow forced into forming a lattice. And suppose this lattice has a lattice constant A. Now, when this lattice is much larger than the natural size of the hydrogen atom, which is A naught or the Bohr radius, then you can think of this in the band theory of solids, it ought to be a metal. And therefore, as you change the lattice constant of even this imagined collection of this transition is called a Mott transition. You see, it is still according to the band theory of solids, even for the largest lattice constants, it is still a half-filled band. So it ought to be a metal, but it actually is an insulator. And this transition has been observed in a very large number of systems. There are systems known which are called Mott insulators, which are insulators simply because the lattice constant is more than what it should be if it were to obey band theory. Then you can ask, why is this so? It is so because in these systems which are insulators, local repulsion between two electrons is very large. Now, why does that make a difference? It makes a difference because if the local repulsion between two electrons is very large, you can put only one electron at a particular site. I mean, a certain number of electrons. If you change that number by bringing in one electron from somewhere to that site, then the energy becomes very large. And this energy is described in terms of this repulsion. This repulsion, U, is parameter which controls whether the thing is going to be a metal or an insulator. So there are two energies in the system. This was first recognized by Hubbard. One energy is the potential energy of a repulsion between two electrons when they are very close to each other, and the other energy is T, which is the energy of hopping, the kinetic energy. See, if unless the electrons hop in a lattice from one side to another, the electrons are not moving, and therefore you don't have the possibility of a metal at all. So if the kinetic energy, so the question is, what is the kinetic energy, the size of the kinetic energy in relation to the size of the potential energy? If these two are very different, if the potential energy is much larger than the kinetic energy, then you have an insulator. If the potential energy is smaller or of the same order as the kinetic energy, you have a metal. So this I have tried to show here in a picture, which I am encircling with my cursor. The picture shows a lattice. It shows atoms as circles. It shows them as having spins pointing in one direction or the other, and it shows some sites in which there are two electrons, and if there are two electrons, there is an extra energy. On the other hand, an electron from one site can hop to another site quantum mechanically, and this gains for the system in energy T. So the entire story which I'm going to talk about is dependent on the relationship between this potential energy U and this kinetic energy T. Now, it's a very long story, therefore I will cut it short. I will just mention that metals in which the potential energy U is larger than the kinetic energy T have very strange properties. These are expected to have strange properties because you see, you have a very strange thing happening. You have electrons moving all over the solid, strongly avoiding each other. They avoid each other because if they come to be in very close contact with each other, then they have to pay a very large potential energy cost. But there are places in the lattice where they can go without having to pay this energy cost. So the electrons can move around over large distances, but they have to strongly avoid each other. Now, under such conditions, what are the properties of a metal and how do we describe these properties? Now, this is an ongoing effort, and I will just mention three of the possibilities. One is that all these systems seem to have a very small characteristic temperature, T star, above which it behaves like a bad metal. What is a bad metal? Well, there are many ways of describing a bad metal. One way is to say that it has an electrical resistivity which is linear in temperature to the highest accessible the highest accessible temperatures to us. The other thing which is very peculiar about these strongly coated electron metals is that they show unconventional superconductivity at low temperatures. So I will just show examples of these. In this slide, which is not very clear, I show the thermopower S of a compound called sodium cobaltate for different values of doping. These different values are labeled as 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. And you notice, hello?
Sir, just a minute. Ramesh Arumugam, stop presenting. You are presenting the screen. Stop presenting. Ramesh Arumugam, please stop presenting. Speaker, screen is not visible. Ramesh, stop presenting. Just disconnect your meeting.
Are things better now?
Just a minute, sir. Actually, somebody is presenting. Your presentation is not visible. Now it's correct. Now it's correct. Okay.
Now it's correct. So, can I go on? Can I go on now?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. You present it again, sir.
Doesn't matter, but I mean, I can start from here. I wanted to say the following thing, that there is a large class of materials which are metallic and in which the effect of the interaction between electrons in this metal is very strong. And this local means that unless two electrons come near to each other within an atomic distance, the repulsion is not particularly large. But if they do come to distances within an atomic size, the repulsion is enormous. And that is why the electrons have to move around in a solid, avoiding such encounters. So that is why these are called strongly correlated electronic materials. In such strongly correlated electronic materials, we find very peculiar properties. The first of which I'm showing now in this slide. In this slide, I am showing the thermopower, which is on the y-axis, as a function of the temperature, which is on the x-axis, the therm of a particular compound called sodium cobaltate. Now, in this sodium cobaltate, you make many varieties of sodium cobaltate by changing the amount of sodium in it. And if you increase the amount of sodium, you begin to see the following feature, that the thermopower, which conventionally the thermopower is expected to be linear in temperature of the thermopower of a metal is expected to be linear in temperature. Reason is that the thermopower is due to the entropy carried by the electrons. These electrons are highly degenerate. They form a Fermi gas and the entropy they have is very, very small. And therefore the thermopower is small and it can be shown to be linear in temperature. So it is linear in temperature for a particular value of X here, which is labeled as 1. Then you begin to see that as you increase X, the thermopower shows some characteristic temperature, which is, let us say, 125 degrees in this case. Increase the amount of X, it shows that characteristic temperature. The same characteristic temperature is shown in all these samples of sodium cobaltate. Now, this is very strange because the only characteristic temperature you expect in a metal is the Fermi temperature. Sorry, I have to shut off this phone finally. Yeah, I've done that. What do you expect? You expect that this linear behavior in temperature of thermopower will keep on going till you reach a temperature of the order of the Fermi temperature, which in these systems is like 10,000 degrees, a few thousand degrees at least. So the linearity should continue till about 1,000 degrees, a few thousand degrees. But what do you see? You see that the thermopower sort of shows some signs of saturation and even decrease at a characteristic temperature of about 150 degrees, which is much, much less than the only obvious temperature scale of this electronic system, which is the Fermi temperature. This I have shown in another slide here. This is a much more recent slide of the thermopower of lanthanum strontium vanadate doped with differing amounts of strontium. That in some cases, the temperature, the thermopower is linear in temperature. But in most cases, it is not linear. I mean, it shows a sort of a peak, in this case, a somewhat broad peak at about 500 degrees. But you begin to see that it begins to deviate at about 230. So this low characteristic temperature of these strongly correlated systems, which governs their physical properties. Now, well, we don't quite understand what this is. Here is the example of a numerical simulation. This numerical simulation was done by two physicists, George and Cotillard, and published be physically united. So, and this numerical simulation shows a particular physical property, resistivity. And actually, if you look very close, you find that at very low, and it shows the function of temperature, and temperature is in units of the bandwidth of the system. And you see that at very low temperatures, that is at temperatures very small compared to the bandwidth, the resistivity is actually, which goes very clearly as T square, that is shown more explicitly in this inset. You see, it goes as T square. But as you increase the temperature, it begins to go linearly with temperature. So there is a crossover temperature which is very low. You see, below that it goes as T square, above that it begins to go as T. And that fact is exhibited in this graph. That is, you show here the temperature as a function of the bandwidth. Temperature, the ratio of temperature and the bandwidth is a dimensionless number, as a function of the doping. You see, what these people numerically analyzed was what is called a doped Hubbard model, and they analyzed the properties of this as a function of doping, and they found that the low temperature behavior is confined to really low temperatures, which is shown here in blue, and the linear in resistivity behavior, which is called a bad metal behavior, is confined to somewhat higher temperatures, and this bad metal region is shown as red. And in between, there is a rather large region in which it crosses over from being a sort of good metal to a bad metal. And the crossover temperature is rather low. It depends on the doping, but it is a very small, I mean, it's a small fraction of the doping. This is the crossover temperature, about 0.05 times the doping, which is a dimensionless number, doping density times the hopping energy. So numerical calculations also support this fact that there ought to be a low crossover temperature. The origin of this is not clear, but these are unprejudiced numerical simulations. That is, you take the two-dimensional Hubbard model and do an unprejudiced numerical simulation. Okay, now I come to the question of linear resistivity, which is one of the very characteristic properties of these solids. As a matter of fact, linear resistivity is the property of all metals, except at very low temperatures. I mean, if you take, at least when I was a student, we used to do something called platinum resistance thermometer. We used to take a piece of platinum and then used to measure the resistivity of this piece of platinum. And we noticed that it's linear in temperature. And using this linearity, you can actually use the resistivity of platinum to measure the temperature. Now, in 1986, two physicists, many physicists, Martin Fiori and Waxack, they found that the resistivity of particular form of a particular member of the strongly correlated electron metal family, which is for physicists called as Bi2201, and whose perhaps honest composition is Bi2SR2CuO6. This metal shows a linear resistivity from 7 degrees Kelvin to 700 degrees Kelvin. So this is enormous, because the linearity in resistivity begins at pretty low temperature, 7 degrees, and it goes on till 700 degrees, which is about the highest temperature they could measure before the system disintegrated. More recently, about a year back, people have actually been able to measure the resistivity of a system which was mentioned earlier, graphene. So this is what is called a twisted bilayer graphene. That is, you take two layers of graphene which are very close to each other, maybe a few angstroms apart, and then twist one layer with respect to the other. If the if the angle of twist is about 1.1 degrees, it turns out that flat bands appear in the system, flat electronic energy bands appear in the system near the chemical potential. And as a result, the system begins to has acquired very strange properties, one of which is the linearity and resistivity. Now, in this graphene, in this version of graphene, the characteristic electronic temperature, that is the Fermi temperature, is very low. It is just about 28 degrees Kelvin, very, very low. And we see here the resistivity of bilayer graphene as a function of the angle of twist. You see, this is the resistivity, well, which is not visible here, but at least you can see 1.06. You can see that 1.06, the resistivity keeps on increasing linearly with temperature. And it just goes on. I mean, it doesn't saturate, it goes on, and the Fermi temperature is somewhere here. So the resistivity is linear right from the lowest temperature, which you can measure, to the highest temperature at which the resistivity has been measured. So this is amazing that there is a system which shows linear resistivity behavior over this huge range. Now you can ask, why do you bother about resistivity? Well, we bother about resistivity because the resistivity measures the properties of the electrons. The electron has to move from one end of the solid to the other in order for this system to conduct current. And whether it conducts current easily or not easily is dependent on the resistivity. So the property, the ease with which an electron can move is determined by the resistivity. And what this shows is that the electron finds it equally easy to move from one end of the solid to the other if you remove this temperature factor. Okay. The last thing I want to show or talk about is the occurrence of unconventional superconductivity. I think I'm running out of time already, so I will just say the following thing, that superconductivity was discovered in 1911. It was a microscopic theory was for it was provided in 1957, and this theory involved effective attraction between two electrons due to the exchange of lattice vibrations or phonons. So from then on, people began to think that, look, unless you have a glue which binds a pair of electrons to each other, and this pair of the metal which now becomes a collection of this pair of electrons, this metal, these pairs of electrons, which are called Cooper pairs, they all condense into a single quantum state, which is the superconducting state. Unless this happens, you will not have a superconductor, which means that a glue is necessary in order to form pairs, and then these pairs condense. Now, in strongly correlated electron systems, there is only repulsion. So there is no glue, but then you can, therefore you can expect, you may expect, that these strongly correlated electronic systems will not form superconductors because there's only repulsion. However, they do form superconductors, and as a matter of fact, the superconductors with the highest transition temperatures known to man are metals with strong electronic correlations. So then you ask the question, why is it that they form superconductors? Well, we have some inkling of. But then we don't have an answer to the question of, do all strongly correlated metals form superconductors? Well, we don't know. Well, I will just say that people have not been, theorists like me have been trying hard to understand the nature of these systems and to describe, to see whether they can be described in a sensible way, but we have not been successful. I mean, I will just rush through, there's a whole list of theoretical attempts extending, I would say, over the last 30-40 years. They have not been particularly successful. I will just conclude I would like to say the following thing, that in physics, certainly in condensed matter physics, it happens that you don't wait for a theory, you don't wait for an explanation, you don't wait for understanding before you begin to use the material for applications. And this is not a new thing. You see, Jagadish Chandra Bose in 1901 described something which he called a coherer. This coherer was an extremely efficient way of detecting microwaves or radio waves. Now, this coherer actually turns out to be a lead sulfide semiconductor. He did not know why it was efficient, but it was efficient and he could make it reproducibly, and it worked. In a similar way, correlated electronic systems or correlated metals or correlated solids, which show what is called mottness, or the insulators which are insulating because of strong electronic correlations, their properties form a branch of physics called mottronics. These are all new words. These areas, they are probably rich in completely unimagined applications. We may understand the behavior of strongly correlated electronic systems, or we may not, but the search for applications has been going on for the last 15 years very actively. One approach is to plow the field. That is, you know, there is a huge field of strongly correlated electronic systems, and you just plow it and then see whether something interesting emerges or not. And this is the theme of the Japanese program of world-leading innovation in R&D. This was led by Tokura in Riken in Japan, where it has been led for the last 10 years or so. Another area, another way of working the same field is to work on focused work on specific applications. I will just mention two. One of them, and there is a very grand sounding title called "Strongly Correlated Materials Could Enable New Applications in Computing, Sensing, and Infrared Camouflage." Now, this appeared in Chemical and Engineering News just a few months ago. One content is the following. There is an object called vanadium dioxide. This is a strongly correlated material. This shows a transition from a metal to an insulator on cooling below 68 degrees, which is just about room temperature. And the thing is whether this metal to insulator transition. So the fact is this, above this 68 degrees, it is actually an insulator. Below this, it's a metal. So the fact that it has an insulator to metal transition is very important, because insulator doesn't conduct current, metal conducts current. So whenever, if at all you have applications which depend on whether something conducts current or not, then this is just the right thing to do. Now, the hitch is that this transition should be reversible and fast, and should be reproducible on repeated cycling. Now, this is not easy, and it has taken a very long time to achieve this. And one of the people who achieved it is Ramanathan, who showed in 2006 that if you take a thin film of vanadium dioxide and deposit on glass, and if you hit it with a laser beam, then it can transform from a transparent electrical insulator to a reflective metal in just hundreds of femtoseconds. It's a very short time period, and it can be done repeatedly. And this has applications in optoelectronic data transfer. And the second application which I want to mention is the resistance of a thin film of YBCO, which is again a member of the cuprate family. It's a strongly correlated metal. If you change the amount of oxygen in this YBCO, you can take it from an insulator to a metal. You can change the amount of oxygen not just by removing or adding oxygen to it, but actually making it a part of an electrical circuit and applying a bias voltage more or less to it. If you apply a bias voltage of about 1 volt, it's a metal, there is less oxygen deficiency, there's more oxygen there. If you apply a bias voltage of 4 volts, 6 volts, 8 volts, progressively you are removing more and more oxygen and it becomes an insulator. So what happens is the following. Suppose you are sitting at a particular temperature, like room temperature, somewhere here, and you look at different values of the voltage, you apply different values of the voltage. Then for some high values of voltage is an insulator, medium values is an insulator, again it's an insulator, again now it becomes a metal. So this is very important in the, some forms of computing. For example, what is called neuromorphic computing, that is the way they we compute. The way we compute is that there is a junction, and in this is a junction, synaptic junction, which you know, has a high conductance in one state, medium conductance in another state, low conductance in another state. Now, if you want to reproduce this so that you want to compute like a human being, then you have a gate, a source and a drain, and then you change the gate voltage, then you have a metal, you have a metal here, you are tending to have an insulator here, and you have a very good insulator here. So you can actually copy neurons which compute by producing such junctions. And if you have a very large number of such junctions connect, interconnected in a certain way, you can have something which is analogous to V computing. And this is a very important area of applications. Well, I want to conclude now and thank you very much for your patience. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for for a very informative talk on metals with strong electronic correlation. Now the presentation is open for questions.
Sir, good afternoon, sir. This is Ankush, and I have a very basic question to ask, that in the theory of Bloch electrons, Bloch theory of electrons in metals, the idea of effective mass of electron, is this idea physical or it is just a way to account for lattice interaction with electrons?
It is both. It is a way to account for the interaction of electrons with lattice, and it is physical and it is measured. I mean, you do experiments which measure the effective mass of particles, and you do find that the effective mass is different from the electron mass, and you do find actually now people can calculate the band structure of many solids with such principles, and therefore they can calculate effective masses. And those calculated effective masses and the measured effective masses are in agreement, and both of them are different from free electrons.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Sir, and next question is that what is stopping any strongly correlated electron system from being superconductor? You raised the question that we can't comment if every strongly correlated electron system is a superconductor. What is stopping us to comment?
Okay, let me sort of go back to wherever it was. Yeah, you see, the point is this. If you have a strongly correlated electron system, it means by definition that two electrons, when they come very close to each other, they repel each other very strongly, which means that under those conditions you can't form a pair of these electrons. So it means that these two electrons which you like to form pairs, they have to be at a certain distance from each other. If they are at a certain distance from each other in order to minimize the repulsion, the superconductor which results has an internal wave function which has what is called, it does not have an S wave symmetry. It may have a C wave symmetry, it may have a P wave symmetry, it may have an S wave symmetry, and so on. The most common observed symmetry in these systems is D wave, and such superconductors are called unconventional superconductors, because the conventional superconductors which were first discovered and were explain whose property were explained by Bardeen, Cooper and Schieffer. They have what is called an internal wave function symmetry. Now, so it is quite reasonable that electronic systems with metals with strong electronic correlations will have unconventional superconductivity. What is not clear is whether they will all become superconducting or not. See, there is an analogous problem in simple metals. In the case of simple metals, the question is, will all simple metals become superconducting if you cool them enough? And this question, it is being explored very actively. For example, will copper become a superconductor when you cool it to extremely low temperatures? We don't know the answer. I mean, people have cooled it to millikelvin degrees and it has not become superconductor. So similarly, there is a question here as to whether all strongly correlated metals will become unconventional superconductors when cooled to sufficiently low temperatures. We don't know the answer.
TVR. This effective mass is because of the lattice as well as the Coulomb repulsion, Coulomb correlation.
Are
both additive?
God knows. I mean, God of course knows. He knows everything. But we physicists do not know. We make the assumption that under many conditions, they are additive. That is, you see, you can build in something like this. You can start with electrons interacting with each other. So electron-electron interaction gives you a certain effective mass. These objects are moving around in a potential, periodic potential, that changes the mass of those. And that would be sort of multiplicative. Often you think of them as independently acting, so you think of them as additive. So there are both possibilities.
What is a thing which makes the ordinary metal different than the heavier atom metals, as you were talking? What is the things which is making them behave very differently?
This is a very, it's a very troublesome question. What is making them different is what people believe to be the short-range interaction between the size of the short-range interaction between the electrons. That is, if electrons happen to come close to each other to distances of the order of an atomic size, is the repulsion comparable or larger or smaller than the kinetic energy?
That is the electronic repulsion you are talking, no?
Right.
But are they being screened by something? Then they will become sharp?
This is the screened repulsion. Always screened interaction.
So they can become very short range.
So the effective interaction between electrons in metals is always short range, as you know very well. Screened interaction, screening distance is maybe an angstrom or so. So the effective interaction is short range. The question then is the effective interaction very large or not large?
Okay. Sir, I have Sachral Mishra. And
yes, please.
What is the basic difference between conventional and unconventional superconductor, and what Cooper pair has to do with it?
The difference between a conventional and unconventional superconductor is in the nature of the wave function of this Cooper pair. The Cooper pair consists of two electrons. See, just as the hydrogen atom wave function consists of an electron and wave function of an electron and a nucleus. So when you think of the wave function of the hydrogen atom, you say, it is the S wave function, P wave function, is in the D state and so on. Similarly here, the two electrons which form a Cooper pair, are they in a relative S state, P state or D state? If they are in an S state, we say it's a conventional superconductor. If they are in a P or D state, we say it's an unconventional. It's a, let us say, conventional distinction. Now, about the second question, why Cooper pairs? You see, this is a very important question. because so far as we know, all the superconductors that have been experimentally studied, they all consist of pairs of electrons, and these pairs were first. Cooper was the person who first showed that if there is an attraction between two electrons, no matter how weak the electrons will bind. Now this flies in the face of quantum mechanics, because free particle quantum mechanics. Because in free particle quantum mechanics, you believe that in three dimensions, unless the strength of attraction between two particles is more than a certain amount, they will not form a bound state. In metals, it turns out that because of the presence of the Fermi, surface of Fermi energy, which means that there are all the other electrons which are around, and that means that because of the Pauli exclusion principle, you can't put this electron on one of these two electrons in these states in which there are already electrons. So because of this peculiarity, it turns out that the weakest attraction can bind electrons from Cooper pairs. Now the next question is, so what? Already they form a Cooper pair. Then it turns out that unless all these Cooper pairs are in the same, on a single quantum mechanical state, the thing is not a superconductor. Now, when we look at superconductivity in strongly correlated systems, we come to a very different situation. Firstly, there is no attraction between electrons. Without attraction, you are forming Cooper pairs. And these Cooper pairs condense. How does it happen? That's an interesting question.
Thank you, sir.
So we'll take last question. Yeah.
Yes, sir. There is a question from Devika Devnath from YouTube. She's asking that we define resistivity in metals and superconductors by considering both electron-electron and electron-phonon interaction. So are these two different mechanisms dominating each other? She wants any comment.
Nikhe, I philosophically, I believe that you should not worry about theory too much. Though I'm a theorist. You should look at the resistivity. For example, in this case, you look at the resistivity. By looking at the resistivity, whether you can say whether this resistivity is due to electron-electron interaction, electron-lattice interaction, or both, it's a difficult question. People believe that in simple clean metal, the resistivity which you observe, like suppose you have clean copper, clean aluminium, the resistivity which you observe is largely due to electron lattice interaction. The role of electron interaction in resistivity is generally quite small. It turns out that in somewhat disordered metals at very low temperatures, the electrical resistivity goes as T square, the square of the temperature, which seems to be a signature of the fact that this resistivity is due to electron-electron interaction. The reason electron-electron interactions are not expected to cause resistance is that, you see, if you have interaction between electrons, the total momentum of the electrons must be the same, must be conserved, it won't change. If the total momentum does not change, the total current carried by this collection of electrons cannot change. If the current carried by the collection of electrons cannot change, then there cannot be resistivity. So, if you have that is why, unless you have a disorder system and you have interaction with electrons, you can admit now, it turns out that there is a contribution, otherwise there is. Now, in these strongly correlated electronic systems, there is a linear term in the resistivity which is observed over a very wide range of temperatures. People tend to believe that even in clean systems, since you observe this resistivity, and since the electron-electron interactions are very large, and since the electron-lattice interactions can never give rise to this large resistivity, therefore, this resistivity must be due to electron-electron interactions. These are all inferences. But what you measure is something else.
Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you so much, sir, Professor TVR, for giving this exciting talk on metals, strong electronic correlation. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you. And if the participant, if they have any questions, and then if Professor TVR, if he allows, they can write you a mail for asking any doubt or if they have any queries related to talk.
Perfectly. You are most welcome to email me. My email ID is tvrama2002@yahoo.co.in. tvrama2002@yahoo.co.in. And all this is continuous, all this is lowercase. Thank you.
Thank you, TVR, for accepting our invitation.
Thank you.
It's always a pleasure to talk to you. Always a pleasure.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much. Our next talk, it will be at 3:30 p.m. by Dr. Navinder Singh from Physical Research Laboratory, Ahmedabad. So I request the participant to please log in the meeting exactly at 3:20. Okay. So we'll meet again at 3:30 p.m. today for the second talk. Yeah. Thank you. Thank you, all of you. Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you.